Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming. My thanks to the UNDP and its Kapuscinski lecture series at the University of Cyprus. I'm very honored to be here, and I hope if I succeed at the end of the day or the evening, that I confuse you a little, that I make you a little more prone to act, responsibly, of course, because the world has changed. The world has changed in a significant way, primarily because of the information technology revolution. The globalization engine that started in the 1990s has changed the world irreversibly. And it's primarily because of what we call instant connectivity and deepening interdependence, both of which are good for us, but they bring risks, of course, like everything else. Now, I, as you heard, extra kind words from the professor, I transcend three disciplines. My original discipline, which is neuroscience, which is the study of the brain and its cellular and neurochemical foundations of behavior. I'm also done a lot of work in political philosophy in terms of governance paradigms, where I advocate that sustainable governance, in my book, which I call Sustainable History, sustainable governance is predicated on the idea of the attainment and the guarantee of dignity for all, at all times, and under all circumstances. It turns out that actually human dignity defined as far more than just the opposite of humiliation. It's an inclusive, holistic, governance-based paradigm, which I talk about in my book. It turns out that actually dignity-based governance paradigms is far more profound, a far more profound human need than political freedom. So you can have, even in mature democracies today, you can have political freedom, but you can be disenfranchised. You see it all the time. In the US, for example, just as a simple example from data from 2009, the US has 300 million people, 50 million of which are at or below the poverty line. Now, that is shocking to most people, but that is a fact. There's tremendous political freedom, tremendous political system, and yet a lot of people fall behind. So to me, political freedom is important, but human dignity is far more profound as an emotional repertoire for human psychology. And the third facet of my thinking is geopolitics. Now, we live in a world with no overarching authority. So it's what we call a self-help system. In other words, the UN system works, but up to a point. It arbitrates, but it has no mechanism to enforce decisions that are reached. And of course, to my mind, it's a dysfunctional entity. It's better than having nothing, but it remains very dysfunctional. And if I was in a very quick, simplistic suggestion would be to get rid of the veto system and expand the Security Council members, because there are a lot of members that belong there. And the current structure of the UN Security Council, UNDP aside, they do a great job, is that this is a 1945 structure of the victors of World War II. It has little relevance to today's world that is very complex, very connected, and very interdependent. So this is the framework. Now, disruptive technologies, as we call them, have been operationalized for the most part by the information technology, the revolution of the 1990s. And they include such things as artificial intelligence, 3D printing, 4D printing, synthetic biology, which is, I'll talk about that later, cognitive enhancement. Some of you may not know much about it, but it's a very serious enterprise. It's a very exciting enterprise, but has tremendous amount of risk. And so what I'll do in my talk, I'll oscillate between these three disciplines, i.e. political philosophy, neuroscience and geopolitics, because in today's world, everything is interdisciplinary. Now, disruptive technologies are a problem, and they are a problem for the following reasons. One is that there's tremendous amount of innovation, and in fact, it's going at an exponential rate, which is good for all of us. Your iPhone is a simple example. There are 100 things that are of benefit to humanity today, but there are issues, and the reason transformative, what we call transformative and disruptive technologies are a serious issue is one, because a lot of them have what we call dual use. So states, countries, for security and military reasons are very interested in these things. So a lot of the times we're not even aware of half of what's being developed. That's number one. Number two, there are corporate entities that have a tremendous amount of reach within the IT world, who have some regulation, but not as much regulation as you think. Thirdly, there are non-state actors, what we call non-state actors, who are who are enabled and quite able in the use of these technologies. So this kind of dual use, the inability or the lack of wish of certain states to talk about certain technologies, corporate entity, corporate profitability, make this a little more difficult. In addition to a very central issue, which is related to both political philosophy, neuroscience, and geopolitics, which is the aspect of human security. I'll talk about big data. Some of you may have heard of what big data is. Big data is the idea of accumulating massive amounts of data on everybody and everything. It's done primarily by states. It's also done by corporate entities like the Googles of this world. And there are very few geostrategists who would argue with the need of a state to accumulate any amount of data it deems desirable to keep us all secure. None of us would object to that. But there's a fine line between having an endless amount of data and intrusion on privacy and civil liberty. To my mind, privacy is dead. May it rest in peace. Civil liberties are in trouble. And unless, thus the ethics and the oversight, which I'll talk about. Unless we guard our civil liberties, we will have a problem as a global society down the line. Now, the other thing that is of relevance is the idea that innovation is always ahead of regulation. And so it should be. If innovation was not ahead of regulation, it means we're not innovating enough. But we, in terms of regulatory frameworks and oversight mechanism, we must never lag behind. And to me, the golden rule in today's world is probably 5 to 10 years. If you're 10 years behind the technology in terms of regulating it, you're late. I suspect within a decade or two, that will shrink probably a year or two because of the disruptive nature of these technologies. Now, before jumping in, let me talk to you about man, you and I. My neurophilosophical view of man is neither Hobbesian nor Russian, and it is that man, to me, is an emotional, amoral egoist. So, which means what? That man is far emotional than we think he is. We are, at best, amoral creatures, so we're not immoral. We're not miserable, like Hobbes would say. But we're not necessarily moral. And our moral compass is governed, for most of us, most of the time, some of you may start throwing something at me and say, I'm not like that. I'm saying most people, most of the time, we are emotional, amoral egoists, where our moral compass is governed primarily by our perceived emotional self-interest. And the perception is as relevant as reality. So the emotionality prefix is critical, because sometimes our emotionality actually sabotages the very self-interest we think we're guarding. Because we're highly emotional creatures, we heard about fear. Primordially, everything we do is pro-survival. We may not be aware of it, we may not think it that way, But we are, you know, John Locke, the British philosopher of the 17th century, talked about tabula rasa, which is clean slate. In one of my books, I challenged that and I said, we are not a tabula rasa. We are what I call a predisposed tabula rasa. And the idea being that we have an inbuilt microchip, a biological microchip that is pro-survival. So we may be, and the idea of morality, there's a lot of talk about what we call innate morality. I find no evidence, neuroscientifically or neurophilosophically, that we have innate morality. We have what we call innate moral sensitivities. That's quite different. And when fear is the order of the day, when your survival is at stake, all bets are off. So we must, I've said in my various writings, we must never be complacent about the virtues of human nature. Even the most stable settings can descend into major chaos in very little time if there's fear, if survival was at stake. So we shouldn't be judgmental about war-torn entities because hell is breaking loose, and if you and I, God forbid, would find ourselves in a place like that, I have no clue what we will do. The second point that is of relevance is the idea of power, political power. And what I'm talking about is political power, whether it's checked or unchecked in democracies or autocracies. It turns out, I wrote a paper called The Neurochemistry of Power. And it turns out that actually power is very intoxicating. It is a profoundly pleasurable enterprise. At the neurochemical level, and it is impossible and unfair to expect anybody to give it up willingly. The reason it works in democracies is because people know that at a certain point in time they have to exit. But even then, they don't like it. And if there are lots of historical examples, you know, Mrs. Thatcher, for example, she stayed just a little bit too long, and she didn't like it when she had to leave. What happens after a while, this is all neurochemical. What happens after a while is you become paranoid as a leader, even if you're democratically elected. So your advisory circle becomes smaller and smaller, and you reject any critique. You see it as an assault on you and everything you stand for. There's also the issue of what we call the divinity of kings. It turns out that actually these neurochemicals, as a result of political power acquisition, most of which is dopamine, but there are other neurochemicals, if they're at a very high rate, you become delusional without knowing it. So you claim divine connectivity. And thus, you heard in 2003 Iraq war, two leaders, nameless, said God told them to go and do this. Some of them believe this, actually. Most of it is political hogwash. But some of it is actually heavy neurochemical intoxication due to the profound pleasure of power that makes people do very dumb things. So this is critical to keep in mind. Don't be fooled by sensible, sophisticated, educated, enlightened souls. All of us are corruptible by power. And that's why successful societies are the ones who have put limitations on that. Global security. The rector kindly talked about my multi-sum security principle, where I said that in a globalized world, zero-sum paradigms no longer work. The old adage of power accumulation and the idea, what we call a security dilemma. So if you country X accumulate power, in response I accumulate power, and it's an endless accumulation of power in terms of security threat. I said in that quote that in a globalized world of connectivity and interdependence, security cannot be thought of as a zero-sum paradigm. It must be a multi-sum paradigm where no state will be secure if every other state is not secure. Now that is not operational today, but it will be. And I also said in another quote that nobody is too distant, too different, or too dysfunctional to be left behind, because it will come back to bite the global system. The global system is enabled primarily by asymmetric threats through very sophisticated technologies. And I said in that quote that justice, defined minimally as fairness, we can talk about justice philosophically for a long, long time, but defined minimally as fairness, must be a prerequisite to sustainable security and sustainable governance. I think I'll stop here in terms of just framing the discussion. Now, how do I push the... Can I do it here?
Yeah, just press.
Sure. Okay. So, disruptive technologies. I go through very quickly various kinds of disruptive technologies that I think are relevant. And again, as you listen to this, always oscillate between human nature as an emotional, amoral, egoism paradigm, between a global system that is a self-help system that has no overarching authority to arbitrate a little but not to enforce, and the idea that these technologies are pervasive, they're exponential, and they're beyond the control of states. Often they are in the hands of technology companies and non-state actors. This goes without saying. Again, the robotic angle you see at the bottom is very relevant. And there I hope to worry you a little, but maybe excite you a little, but I think it's a serious challenge for humanity as we know it in the next, probably by mid-century. So this is self-explanatory. Again, what I said earlier about the exponential growth of technology, it's going at an extremely high rate, and it's likely to go faster. Primarily because of the confluence of a lot of technologies that are coming together. So we call them disruptive, we call them transformative, we can call them evolutionary or revolutionary. Some have been around but have been operationalized by new technologies, whether it's computational power or computational logic. For example, genome sequencing, as a lot of you may know, was really enabled by bioinformatics. It was really the information technology revolution that allowed the sequencing to occur. And you can apply that to a lot of other things. So technology in itself is neither good nor bad. Actually, it can be very good. It can make our lives wonderful. It is probably quite useful, as I'll talk about later, in space exploration. It is good, hopefully, if addressed correctly, for climate security. It is useful for medical diseases that we know very little about. But we must never ignore the potential for misuse in terms of these technologies. And again, as a scientist at heart, I would never, nor I'm sure all of you, would never want to do anything to stifle innovation. Innovation is good for us. It is here to stay regardless, but it's good for us. We just want to be sure that we mitigate the risks. We're unlikely to be able to prevent all risks, but I think if we mitigate them, we minimize them, then I think we're doing well. Security, I talked about the five dimensions of global security, which is, as I said, national security, transnational security, environmental, human, and transcultural security. All of them are affected by technology. As a pro-security and as an anti-security. This is my book of, I think, 4 or 5 years ago, where I talked about the five dimensions of global security. And in it, the multi-sum security principle that the rector kindly alluded to, where the central take-home message from that is that justice, defined minimally as fairness, is an absolute prerequisite to sustainable security for humanity. Now, some people may not want to hear that, because they think that's kind of moralistic, idealistic. It's not. Human nature being what it is, enabled by these very profound technologies, if it's emotionally threatened, it can be very destabilizing. I mean, you see now a lot of non-state actors which are being troublesome in the security field. You're going to get more of those. Not necessarily in the form you see today. So I think while it's a tall order to address everybody's emotionality, everybody's cultural and identity frameworks, there are some commonalities that I think we can all aspire to. So the urgent need from regulatory frameworks is to assess the risk and develop mechanisms for oversight. And for things like big data, which I will mention later, which is this massive collection of data on everyone, the issue here is really over what I call overseeing the overseers. So we have to have mechanisms within governments, again, with security clearance. Some of these things are very sensitive. It's okay to have somebody within the system, but you have to have the mechanism. And to be fair, most mature democracies do that very well, but there's room to improve. So the future is now. I mean, we're at the cusp, I think, now of significant improvement and exponential growth in all kinds, not only in individual technologies, but in the marriage and the confluence of these technologies, which will be synergistic. And we need, in general, as always, with everything else, we need to be proactive rather than reactive. Because in reality, if left unregulated, a lot of things will go wrong. And from an AI and artificial intelligence standpoint, which I'll mention later, married with synthetic biology and some of these significant technologies could be an existential threat to humanity as we know it. So I think this is not small talk. Let's not say we should be dramatic and the end of the world is nigh. It's not like that, but there are issues that must be addressed. Not to mention the human side of it, which is the intrusion on civil liberties and all that stuff. So the idea, if synthetic biology, now some of you may have heard what synthetic biology is. Synthetic biology, unlike biotechnology, is the ability to synthesize pieces of biology, pieces of DNA, short sequence amino acids, that do not exist in nature. Biotechnology is you playing with what's there. So this is a whole new ball game, which is, from a disease standpoint, is very welcome, because we can do a lot of good. But you can also manipulate virulent pathogens, and you can make them far more virulent. You can do a lot of very nasty stuff. This is my book on the politics of strategic technology. And this applies to a concept which I call transhumanism. A lot of people have talked about. Transhumanism is the enhancement of human functions, both physical and cognitive, beyond what we call beyond normal physiology. So it's not like you're like a medical enterprise where you're fixing a dysfunctional organ or a set of cells. You're actually the patient or the person is perfectly fine, and your aim is to enhance them beyond their normal physiology. Now, human enhancement has been with us for a long, long time, whether it's makeup, glasses, knees, pacemakers, and that's fine. There's not a whole lot wrong with that. And even physical enhancement, I don't really have a problem with that, although there's a lot in the military, some of you may have heard about, called the exoskeleton. And it's the idea of applying a skeleton to the human body, which allows you to lift cars and tanks, and that's feasible. That's not science fiction. My concern is not physical, although, again, if that becomes ubiquitous, it could be a source of insecurity. My concern is cognitive enhancement. Given the fact that all of our self, between quotes, whether it's our emotions, ambitions, intellect, memories, are all neurochemical event at the cellular and the subcellular level, theoretically, you can play with that, and you can change it significantly. We do it today with antidepressants and a lot of what we call psychoactive drugs. And of course, the military of various states have been doing this for a long, long time. In Waterloo, it was rum. Rum was the enhancer for soldiers in Waterloo in 1815. In Vietnam, it was amphetamines. In the Iraq War, it was modafinil, which is a very potent psychoactive drug that's supposed to make soldiers a little more aggressive, require less sleep. And of course, some of these things are, some of their consequences at the structural cellular level are irreversible. That some of it is not obvious, but some of it is irreversible. So in a lot of work, in various papers and in this book where I talk about transhumanism, there are two groups of thought amongst intellectuals. One that says transhumanism is a wonderful thing, it's good for us, we should do it. There's another group that says this is very dangerous and we should regulate it out of our procedures. I called it in one of the inevitable transhumanism. So whether you're for it or against it, it's going to happen. And the reason it's going to happen is but what I call the neuro P5. The neuro P5, these are motivators of human behavior, which in a very ironic way, our human nature will push us towards changing our human nature. And the motivator is these P5, which is power, pride, permanency. What I mean permanency is longevity, profit, pleasure. All of these are feasible through a marriage of synthetic biology, neurochemistry, and probably artificial intelligence. So I think these are, so it will take Herculean effort to prevent people from going that route. It's just too enticing. It's too elegant. It's too good. And thus the need to regulate. And of course, one of the central issues is that will produce will be inequality. Because who gets enhanced? Is it economics? Is it political affiliation? Because if you enhance somebody to an IQ of 300, how on earth is that person going to compete with anyone else? Is it fair? Is it societally acceptable? But it's going to happen. It will happen probably within 2 or 3 decades, probably sooner. And the question is it acceptable at the societal level? So this needs to be regulated urgently, at least the cognitive part. The physical part, I think from a civilian standpoint, it's not an issue. From a military standpoint, it's a big issue. So I'll talk about some individual technologies now. Synthetic biology. This is a paper I wrote in Global Policy where I said synthetic biology, what to expect and what to fear. And there's a lot to expect and there's a lot to fear. It's a profoundly potent new technology that will be very good for us, will enable us to deal with a lot of difficulties at the biological level, but will have the potential for misuse and dual use in terms of pathogenicity of various agents. The other thing, of course, regarding synthetic biology, is some of these agents are tiny and they can occasionally get incorporated into the DNA sequence because they're of similar size and produce all kinds of mutations that are unforeseen. Again, synthetic biology is useful because you can do it in agriculture, you can use it in very sophisticated medical technologies. You can actually use it for energy generating hydrogen. So it's a good thing. It's like everything else I've said so far and will say it for the end of the talk. All of this stuff is good. It's wonderful. We want it and we want more of it. But there are sides to it that must be regulated urgently without preventing, without stifling the innovation. That's the trick, I think. Nanotechnology and invisibility. I wrote a paper maybe 2 years ago about, it turns out that nanotechnology, nanomaterials, when you miniaturize materials, they change their properties. For example, gold is yellow, nanogold is black. So whenever you miniaturize materials, you alter their properties. And thus, with the marriage of metamaterials, you actually can delude the human eye into not seeing an object. And the military actually is doing a lot of work on that in terms of evading with radar and human eye. And you can do that. You can reflect the light and you can create the illusion of looking through the object. And you can't tell the difference. And of course, for military reasons, that's a very significant enterprise. So there was an old series called The Invisible Man. I don't know if some of you may remember that. It's upon us. So there's a lot of these things, they sound way out there, but they're not. They're almost. And given the fact, as I said, because of the security and military applications of a lot of these things, a lot of them are not open source. So we're not aware of some of these things. for the WEF, the World Economic Forum, which I'm a member of, and the emerging technology, they asked me to write something, and will biology change what it means to be human? And the answer is yes. Because, again, of this enhancement issues, because of the synthetic biology, we will, I think, enhance ourselves probably within the next 2 decades to a transhuman, what we call a transhuman, and at some point probably a posthuman. Because remember, biology, wonderful though it may be, it's a very inefficient mechanism. You know, we get old, we die, we get sick, and it's not, if you go into a future society where productivity, thus the human side has to be protected, then we're inefficient. We're not very good at a lot of things. We want to sleep, we want to call our loved ones. There's no time for that in a future society. So the likelihood of enhancing people to a level where there's less emotionality, less remorsefulness, is very likely. And it's doable, because as we know more about the neurochemistry of our various mental faculties, we should be able to do that. That is not difficult to do. Knowing what I know about neuroscience and neurochemistry, we know a lot, but in the big scheme of things, we know very little. But then, probably in 2-3 decades, as we get this exponential growth of various technologies, we'll know a lot. And it will enable us to do some very silly things, I think. Precise genetic engineering. Again, you may have read in the UK, the bioethics committee has approved the idea of having a 3-parent baby. So instead of the usual 2-parent baby, this was made into a 3-parent baby, and it was approved through bioethical oversight. And the idea was to correct a particular dysfunctionality at the genetic level. I have no problem with that, but you can see where this could go. I'm all for these innovative ideas. Most sensible people would be. But knowing what I know about how easily, how likely that this will slip into, go off on a tangent, I think we have to regulate it stringently. Predictive analytics, you may have heard this term being thrown around, it's used by the military a lot. And it's the idea, again, is to gather endless amount of data and use AI-based systems, AI, artificial intelligence, to predict certain things. There's actually even I wrote a paper for Scientific American, which is going to come out, I think, next week, called The Biometric of Intent. You can see where technology can actually make people get overambitious and be a little silly. The idea of biometrics of intent is that the idea based on data, face data, or visual, or how dry your lips are, supposedly, you can predict intent or intentionality. You can see why this can go into a really difficult, slippery slope that will definitely infringe on civil liberties and privacies. But technology is here, and some people think, why not use it? And in the corporate world, people, why not make money out of it? And all of the above are fine. We live in a free world, and more power to them, but it has to be regulated, so it's not, doesn't infringe on basic human security. 3D printing, you've heard all about it, and it's supposed to be, it's done in the military, it's used in the military heavily. We can remotely print a 3D object, whether it's part of a gun or part of a tank, and it's happening. I wrote this paper called Printing the Future, I think a year and a half ago. And there's also, and it's actually supposed to be the democratization of manufacturing. So the idea is if you have delivery lines between here and some remote island, you can actually, if you have communication technology, you can actually, they can download it and do it over there instead of, so it's useful. Again, it's like everything else. 4D printing, I wrote this in Foreign Affairs. 4D printing is a very interesting idea, and it's 3D printing with the fourth dimension being time added to it. And the idea is that it autonomously fixes itself. So if you have a wing of a plane as an issue, the metamaterials are made in such a way that they actually can fix the problem without human intervention. Again, with a pipe, if a pipe leaks, whether it's an oil pipe or a water pipe, again, same thing. And you can see in medicine and space, and there are 1,000 things you can do with this. Wonderful, but very scary, very exciting, but very scary stuff. Artificial intelligence. So artificial intelligence, most of you know what that's about. And it is, I think it's a great thing, but eventually, and you, some of you may have heard about the letter recently signed by Professor Hawking and others warning about killer robots and the danger of AI to humanity. And I share that concern. I think it's not immediately upon us, but it's not far. The idea, I wrote another paper, which you will see in Foreign Affairs, on the morality of robots. They asked me to write, from a neurophilosophical standpoint, the morality of robots. How moral is a robot likely to be? And my answer in the paper is that initially it will be as moral as its programmer. Initially. Eventually, as it becomes smarter, it may develop its own source code, in which case it will be independent and may become like us. It may become an emotional, amoral, egoist entity. So I think the likelihood of that happening is high, probably before the end of the century. But I'm almost, I wouldn't say certain, but I would predict that these kind, because you cannot, even in our primitive stage of AI development, there's a lot of sophistication that is mind-boggling. And in time, again, remember the confluence of technology. There's not just one technology going forward, it's the confluence that actually becomes synergistic. Again, it applies to everything. You know, it's really, and the idea of the emotionality of robots. You know, theoretically, at some point, you can, in the initial period, you can program emotionality, you can program morality, and you can program egoism. But as I said, eventually, this machine or these machines may decide that they want to develop their own set of morality or lack thereof. And you see, a lot of the movies, by the way, are not really crazy ideas. I mean, some of them are just ahead of the curve. And people who make these movies actually talk to people in the business. And so they get hints. Of course, they dress it up to make it entertaining. But some central ideas are not far off. Again, artificial intelligence. This is my meta-geopolitical book, where I was, from a geopolitical standpoint, I was advocating that traditional geopolitics needs to be expanded in the age of globalization, and it needs to include these what I call seven state capacities. And AI, like all these transformative technologies, will influence all of these seven. Quantum computing, some of you may know what that's about. You know, your normal computing is the 0-1, and quantum computing uses qubits, and it uses both of them. And so the idea of speed and computational power and logic that results from quantum computing is unbelievably fast and able. And of course, this is NASA is using it today for space, deep space exploration, because it's a very tremendous amount of data that current computing cannot do it. Again, this can be used for militaries, it can be used for health, same old story. It can be used for good things, but for bad things. This is a very interesting idea. Just finished a paper on it, but it's not published yet, on neuromorphic chip technology. And the idea is, it's a sort of AI, it's a sort of artificial intelligence, but the idea is you're mimicking neurons, you're mimicking neuronal populations. And the idea, and people who are interested in this field, is that that should enable us to instill human-like virtues to machines because of this kind of... Okay, good, thank you. So this is another very interesting, fascinating technology that will... IBM is working heavily on this, and I think in the next decade we will see something quite significant. As I said, traditional computers are linear in the way they operate. Neuromorphic chips process information differently, mimicking the brain's architecture. And there are, all kinds of ethical implications of creating machines as smart as humans. And there's actually some talk down the line that, you know, if they're kind to us, they may adopt us as pets. Cognitive enhancement. I mentioned that earlier. What I said, enhancement is really enhancing human function beyond normal physiology. Not pathology, which is what, where you go to the doctor for. It's your normal physiology, and you want to make it better, bigger, smarter. And it's part of cognitive neuroscience, and it's actually being enabled by the marriage of profound molecular genetics, neuroscience, and bioinformatics, and AI-related, and probably with this neuromorphic chip that I just mentioned, which is quite primitive at this stage, but will be quite an enabler. And so the idea is the biological enhancements that amplify or extend capacities of the human brain beyond a normal healthy state. So you're fine, but you want to be more fine than fine. So you want to, again, cognitive enhancement, emotionality, emotions, as I said earlier, emotions are not some parapsychological, supernatural, nonsensical stuff. They are physical, cellular, and subcellular entities. Everything you think is highly emotional has a physical explanation at the cellular level. And so, so given that recognition, and as we know more about it, why not change it? Why not enhance our mental dexterity? Why not control our emotions? Why not make us more emotional, less emotional? Adopt positive emotions, negative emotions, depending on the circumstance. Once you know the underlying mechanisms, you should be able to do whatever you want. So transhumanism, this is the paper I talked about, which I called Inevitable Transhumanism, How Emerging Strategic Technology Will Affect the Future of Humanity. I think this is one aspect that will make us less human and will infringe upon the very idea of humanness. Again, I'm not against it in principle from a neurochemical, neuroscientific standpoint, but I think there needs to be stringent, serious bioethical oversight mechanisms. So again, the transhumanism and the idea, either you enhance yourself, but you can also marry the idea of biology and technology. And there is actually a political movement called transhumanism, which actually, again, some people are for it, some people are against it. I am, say, it's going to happen. I'm not for it or against it. We just have to get ready for it. Brain-computer interfaces, again, that's almost upon us. And the idea of the possibility of human interaction with computers through thought alone. Actually, at Duke University recently, there was a clear example in scientifically verifiable fashion where you can do thought consequences across rooms, across... so this is serious stuff, I think, and this is interesting from a scientific standpoint. But you know, you can see why, from just a very simplistic standpoint, that hackers could use this process to access sensitive critical data, hijack systems, and manipulate it. If you can figure out what the science of it is about. Again, go back to the convergence, the confluence of these technologies. The significant advances in the applicability of these technologies, I think, will come from the marriage of a number of technologies. Whether it's the typical biological medical issues, cancer, but you may have what's called biological print buttons, transhumanism, and the dual use, of course, whether it's the civilian, the military, and this is actually, as I said at the beginning of the talk, this is what's hindering the regulatory frameworks a little bit, because a lot of it is not open source, a lot of it is vital to state security, and so it's not obvious from a military and a state security. So they have military as well as civilian uses. They offer potential opportunities and risks. And it's important for these technologies not to fall into the wrong hands. You know, what are the wrong hands? Maybe the wrong hand is you and me if you want to make somebody with an IQ of 700. It's very relative. Risks, again, decreased security, contamination of the biosphere with the synthetic biology. As I said, if you create tiny DNA material or sequences, theoretically, if it's small enough, it can be incorporated through your bottle of water into your own DNA, thus producing all kinds of mutations. Hacking, and the central, which I, as a humanist, as a neurophilosopher, privacy infringement. I think that's a serious, serious issue for our species going forward. role of policy and regulation. Current regulation is more reactive than proactive. And there's a significant discourse, luckily being raised to the level of UN, about autonomous weapon system, you know, whether it's drones and the like. And the things can do are amazing. That, for example, they can work in swarms. So if one becomes dysfunctional, actually it passes its data and imaging to the next one autonomously from 7,000 miles away. So these are very potent entities. UN, I think, is the individual and self-regulation. And central to all of this is what I said earlier, I think, awareness. If we're aware about these things, we should encourage them, we should welcome them. But I think we should pressure our policymakers in a responsible, cool-headed way to make sure that these things are regulated. And my golden rule, as I said, now, today, it's 5 to 10 years. If regulation is 5 to 10 years behind the innovation, it's fine. If it's longer, then it's a problem. I suspect down the line, we'll need to be a little more swift. But, you know, political processes and parliamentary congressional procedures are very slow. But they may need to be accelerated, because the world is a little faster than it has been. From the AI standpoint, we worry what we call runaway technology possibilities, which is the idea of robotics writing their own source code and therefore disobeying their programmers and then becoming a threat to us. So urgent oversight, we need an exercise of political will, and central to all of this is really, like every aspect of human existence, is really good governance based on justice for all. Yeah, I mean, that sounds 1960s nonsense, but it's real. It's real, it's important. And as because we're regulated, because we're connected, because we're interdependent, nobody can get away with much longer, I think. And that's a good thing. I think this is the end. That's it. I stop here.
So I'm a biologist. I'm Neovisantam. I'm from the University of Cyprus. Since you describe the human being as an emotional, a moral, and egotistical being, so what chance is there that these regulatory mechanisms that you listed in your last slide can ever happen?
Well, that's a very good question. And our amorality, I mean, emotionality is one thing. Egoism is good for us. I mean, that's why we get up in the morning, shower, and comb our hair and go to work. That's egoism. That's good for society. Emotionality is part of our existence. And it turns out, actually, that our emotionality, we used to think of it as a distinct aspect of our personality that's a nuisance. It turns out, actually, now from a lot of studies, that our most rational decisions actually have emotional content. And so as we process our most rational construction of reality, there is all kinds of emotional baggage. The immorality, I mean, I'm happy I'm calling man amoral, unlike Hobbes, who says we're immoral, because I think it's governance structure. The brain, governance structure is the answer to your question. The brain is structured and pre-programmed, if you like, biologically, to seek pleasure. And it doesn't really care how it gets its pleasure. So for example, so our best shot in a responsible society, in a responsible parenting entity, is if for the child, if we couple constructive behavior with feel-good behavior. Because if somebody grows up in an entity where feel-good behavior is connected with destructive behavior, that person will grow up doing that. And so our best shot, it's societal and regulatory frameworks. That's why democracies and open societies work better, because there is the rule of law, there's recourse to individual freedoms and individual rights. And our amorality is a good thing. I mean, I'm happy we're amoral rather than immoral, because then there's no hope. If you look at the Gaussian curve, our amorality in the middle, governance structures and parenting and our school system and our cultural frameworks will push us towards the moral side of the curve. But as I said in my talk, don't be complacent. Don't be fooled just because there's a functioning entity, whether it's a small village, or that everything is okay. The minute the governance structures of accountability and transparency disintegrate, we go back to the state of nature, as Hobbes called it. So it's primordial survival mode. So our amorality is a good thing. That's why successful societies are the ones that are accountable and transparent, because then they keep that amorality to that side of the curve. If you don't have oversight mechanisms in governance structures in dysfunctional societies, then it goes that way. Not because people are bad or good. It's because it's survival. I wrote in one of my books a concept which I called fear-induced preemptive aggression. So it turns out if we're afraid, we become aggressive. Not because we're aggressive. It's because it's I want to get you before you get me kind of thing. So the answer to your question, our immorality is not a dirty word. It is who we are. And human history has proven that when you have good governance structures of accountability and transparency, good things happen. Because people relax. So they don't go into defensive postures.
Yes.
Εγώ.
Ναι, yes.
Γεια σας.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah, good evening. Excellent presentation. I've been to over 30 seminars, and if not the best, one of the best. Okay. My name is Marius Murtuvanis. I'm a humble student of finance. I'm interested about sociopaths right now. I'm very democratic. I love liberty, but because in order to function liberty, we have to be safe. Since we can predict who's going to be a sociopath through a PET scan, I believe it can be done. So would you be consistent with the idea to, before somebody goes to finish his high school, give him a PET scan and see if this is a sociopath, give him a secret code, and keep him isolated, you know, under some guard? What do you think? It's very proactive idea, very innovative, but if you see the things I see in 48 hours behind machine walls of all those sociopaths, if we could get rid of all this unhappiness, it would be very good. And you live in England or America?
I live everywhere.
Okay, this is all the work. Bye, thank you.
Let me just, that would be a terrible idea. It will be a sort of a combination Orwellian world with a brave new world of Aldous Huxley. What makes us human is that we must never be judgmental on others, number one. Number two, our neurobiology is not fixed. So if there is a dysfunctionality of any sort, it is alterable, it is fixable. I think it would be a very dangerous world if we start being judgmental at a certain level and throw people into certain categories. We will lose our humanity, we will make major mistakes, and we'll create more difficulty than we would think we solve. The solution, I think, is to be proactive, as you say, I agree with you, but not in terms of being intrusive. If you're intrusive, you've already made a judgment. You've already made a judgment, and that would be very counterproductive. People can be nice. That's why I said amoral. We're not a bad bunch. Circumstances are critical to how we do certain things. So if society is just, if you're an African-American individual in the middle of the ghettos in the US, now you can, as we found out lately with DNA sequencing, a lot of people have gone to jail over 30 years who've never committed a crime. It's because people thought, aha, you know, and he's likely to have done it. He's around the crime scene. That would be a major intrusion on civil liberties. And when a guy, as you see it on the TV almost every week, somebody coming out of jail, he's been in jail for 20, 30 years, and he never did anything. So I think society, I can't even imagine what that feels like. Knowing that you wake up and sleep every night in a jail cell, knowing you had nothing to do with the thing, but the system decided you are pro-problem, so they withdraw you. So I think humanity, we need to guard ourselves against ourselves. we need to be accurate, we need to be proactive, we need to do the right thing, we need to rehabilitate difficulties, not be judgmental and throw them in the dustbin of history. But we must be humble in our judgments. I mean, these technologies are wonderful. They enable us to do a lot of things, but they are nowhere near our humanity. So I think we have to be humble about what we think we know.
Okay, next, and then next.
I would like to thank you for your talk. My name is Tamatula Panagaku from the Department of Politics. There are many questions, but I'd like to ask you some. First of all, you mentioned the idea of justice as fairness, if you can comment on that a bit. Also, you talk about the bad and good effects of technology, and I would like to ask you, are there any philosophical sources which inspire your thinking? And also, another question about your philosophical standpoint or your overall standpoint, because I was a bit confused, I think, because you have a sort of, you try to have a holistic view of explanation, and then many times you reverted back to the sort of a neuroscience standpoint. So I found it a bit confusing. Thank you very much.
Okay. So justice. I mean, justice to most people, most regular people, or most political philosophers, is a very confusing concept, and it can be interpreted in many, many ways. That's why I say minimally is fairness. However, we define that in a societal framework. And the idea is that to sensible people in sensible times, that somebody's rights and property and are not infringed upon. I mean, it's what modern society has really evolved into. Justice is never perfect. It's never clear. Very few people would agree on the same terms and terminologies. But my point as a concept is that unless we you or I think that we're being treated justly by the system we live in, even if it's a perception, then we'll have a problem. We will not be a functioning member of that society. So justice is a huge, that's why I didn't go into it in great detail, because it can be debated endlessly. I said minimally as fairness. So, you know, you're a teacher in a class, you want to be fair. You want to mark them as fairly as possible. You're not going to get it right all the time. And nobody expects that in a societal framework. What was the second question about neuroscience and there's very little. There's some, but there's very little, because a lot of these exponential technologies are new, and their societal effects really were not seen a decade or two or three ago. Synthetic biology, cognitive enhancement. I mean, you may have heard it probably a decade ago, but very little. Now, as knowledge accumulates, it becomes a concern from a philosophical, moral standpoint. Actually, I'm working with a group in Oxford looking at this very thing, the moral aspect of these technologies. Neuroscience, that's what I know. That's why I go back to it constantly. And if I have and all of my writings and ideas is really takes off from my view of man as an emotional, immoral good. Now, some people may disagree with me. Some people say we're all wonderful creatures. We're not amoral. We're nice. Some people say we're not as emotional as you claim to be. Some people say we are altruistic. I don't believe so. I mean, everybody else has the right to believe what they want. I think human history is full of the idea that man has innate morality or is fair is against human history of brutality, inequality, and miserable circumstances. I think we as human, as biological beings, we aspire initially to survive. And if we survive, some of us may want to dominate. And because we think of it as a pro-survival mechanism. Again, that's being reductionist, deterministic. It doesn't apply to everyone.
Yes, Andrula.
Thank you very much. Let me just start by saying that I'm very pleased that this fantastic lecture took place in Cyprus from an egoistic point of view. You stress very much the need for regulation, and I agree very much, but We know that regulators are usually people that know very, very little about technology, you know, simple technology may be challenging for the regulators. Right. You talked about the leaders wanting to hold on to power and being addicted to power. And of course, to remain in power, they usually work with big interest groups. So maybe no hope from there. You also talked about the possibility of self-regulation in these things. And I mean, recently the Volkswagen scandal is just another show about what self-regulation can do. Is there any hope? And where can we get the hope from for a proper regulation in this area?
Well, I think you raise, Rollo, some very significant ideas. And I think the difficulty with politicians who are an amoral bunch at best, they are motivated heavily by electioneering cycles. I mean, again, one shouldn't be too cynical. I'm sure there are wonderful people who want to do the right thing and want to serve society and want to make the world better. But that's not in contradiction with their own egoisms of wanting to remain significant and do this and that. Thus, the role, as I said earlier, of awareness and constant explanation. But don't be too hopeful that a politician that is high on his agenda. His agenda is the next cycle of electioneering cycle. That's to be expected. But I think if there is political awareness on the part of society and raised through the media, through educational programs, through the entertainment industry, then even if we don't get it all, if we get part of regulatory mechanisms, then it may be self-propelling. If they don't get it, as you see with parliamentary or congressional hearings, they invite experts who simplify things for them and who explain what are the dangers. And in most mature societies, to be fair, as I said in my talk, they try and do the right thing, and they do for the most part. What I'm ringing the bell about is some of these technologies, we don't have the usual time of deliberations and committees, and which you have to have. Those are the checks and balances in any functional system. So I think more awareness, more pressure, and hopefully if you link, as I said earlier, if you couple regulation to re-electability, then you're addressing the egoism stuff. So I think you have to work within people's egoisms. I think if you in general, whether it's your next door neighbor or your corner shop, you have to put that in the equation. Otherwise, you're not going to succeed, no matter how right you are.
More questions? Yes, Chris.
Chris Christodoulou here from Computer Science Department. I call myself Computer Neuroscientist, and I heard a lot of good things from your talk. Just two things I just want to concentrate on. You talked about all the emotions being physically sort of, you can physically explain them, as you said. Mm-hmm. And how definite are you on this? I mean, this is, of course, very questionable, as you probably know better than I do. So the first question is this. And secondly, you kind of, in your talk about the lack of innate morality, you kind of avoided to talk about religion and culture. And the influence in innate morality they might have.
Right.
And of course, that relates to global security as well.
Good points. Innate morality, when I talk about innate morality, I mean innate biologically. I don't mean innate as in growing in a particular environment of religion and culture where you are taught to do the right thing. I'm talking about as a human being, if you grow on an island with no one around.
Even that, you don't know that.
What?
You don't know that there's no innate morality at all. I mean, you know a few things from cellular biology, obviously. Are you sure?
No, we're not sure. What I said is there's no strong evidence for innate morality. There's evidence for moral sensitivities. And people confuse those two things. And the idea is that if you grow in a particular culture or a religious environment which is pro-morality, wonderful, that becomes part of you. But that's not innateness. Innateness, when I talk about innateness, is somebody you're born with, somebody part of your biology, not taught. Your ability to adopt moral frameworks is of course acceptable. Going back to the emotionality and the neurochemistry, of course we know very little about the underpinnings, the physical, structural, cellular, and subcellular, and synaptic underpinnings of cognitive abilities, whether they're emotions or reason or reflection. But there's enough evidence. We don't have all the answers, and we won't have them for a few decades. But there's enough evidence, and the reason for that is if somebody's depressed, right? Somebody has a depression. What do you do with them? You give them an antidepressant. What's an antidepressant? Antidepressant, for the most part, it's what we call serotonin uptake inhibitor. And what it does is keep serotonin, which is a very potent neurochemical, at the synaptic level around longer, so it's a mood elevator. So there's molecular imaging and clinical evidence. And that's why people that are depressed are treated not successfully all the time. It's because we modulate the emotions. I mean, we do it in terms of, as doctors do it. In time, I suspect, probably by mid-century, we will know a lot more than we do now. But there's no question that emotionality has physical, neurochemical foundations. Some of it is genetic predisposition. Some of it is acquired through life, traumatic life experiences. But as I said, you know, when somebody is depressed, you give them a chemical that we know is missing or reduced at a certain synaptic level. That's emotions. That's and that applies across the board. In time, we don't have the answers to all of that, but that is evidence that, you know, people may think that emotions are this parapsychological kind of non-physical. They may be right. I may look like an idiot in 20 years, but if I was a betting man, I would doubt it.
Okay, we'll take one more question from students, preferably. Your student? Yes, okay.
Thank you for the word. In your speech, you mentioned that in a future society, enhanced humans would be viewed as unjust in comparison to normal humans by the current society standards. But in a society where enhancement of humans is available, wouldn't all humans have the opportunity to be enhanced, thus stating a new normal for what human is?
Yes. If everybody has access to it at some point in the future, then I'm not worried about it. My concern, as I said, it's the lack of access for financial reasons, because it may be expensive. Then those who have the financial means will enhance themselves, and those who cannot will not, and therefore you'll have a societal divide. But if the technology is free or available to everyone, more power to it. I'm all for it. It's if there's a select group that can access it and another cannot. That's always my point.
One more student, please. The rector decided, I didn't.
Hello. I'm Athanasia, student of European politics. Thank you for this interesting lecture and for traveling us in the near future. As you said, there is no machine smarter than a human. And I would like to ask you, do you believe that this technology can really create new jobs, positions, and give a new perspective for the young generation? Or just machines will replace people and help rich people to become richer and poor people to become more pure? Thank you.
It's a very good question. And actually, there's a lot of debate on that, whether robotics or artificial intelligent machines are going to increase unemployment. By the way, the same debate occurred around the Industrial Revolution, when these steam engines and the like, people thought that those would make people unemployed, and it didn't. You actually transform societal emphasis to other things. There's plenty in the world that needs to be done. And if machines, I'm all for it, if machines can take care of some of the mundane, boring, heavy, dangerous stuff, then so be it. There will always be good stuff, but I don't think, just like the Industrial Revolution, I don't think it will reduce employment. I think it will be transformative, just like the Industrial Revolution was, and it will be good for humanity.
Thank you very much, Professor Rodhan. I'm sure we can go on forever. We have to close now. Let me remind you, there are some cocktails outside, and please